stars mourn that little children should on his bidding wait. Hosanna in the highest, that ancient song we sing. For Christ is our Redeemer, the Lord of heaven our King. Oh, may we ever praise him with heart and life and voice, and in this blissful presence eternally rejoice.
Good morning. And welcome. A couple of announcements to go over this morning. This week is our Holy Week. We start with our Palm Service Sunday. After service, please feel free to take a palm home with you. Thursday service is at 7 p.m. here. Good Friday service will be at 7 p.m. at the Anointed Faith Tabernacle. Easter Sunday, we have sunrise service at 6:15 in the Recline Commons, which is the closest place we can come to where we started 150 years ago in the Grove. Then we'll have an Easter breakfast at 7 a.m. in the Fellowship Hall, followed by the Easter egg hunt for our kids at 9:30, and our Easter Sunday service at 10. On the 24th, the bells will delight us with their music. Dinah would like everyone to please save your best choice labels. There's more information on the table in the gathering area. The sesquicentennial cookbooks and posters are still for sale, $20 each. And on the railings on the staircase out there, you'll notice we've got these quilts all displayed. These are for one of our community members who is a disabled veteran. He's donating these handmade quilts his wife made, and we offered to sell them, and all of the proceeds will then go to our local Disabled American Vets Club. The silent auction will be going on until July 4th, so if you want to leave your number there, we'll call you when the bid changes and you can re-up your bid. Actually, it was Mother made him. Yeah, that's right. Sorry. Let us be in an attitude of prayer as the acolytes bring the light of Christ into our worship service.
Thank you.
you, ladies. If you will please rise as we praise God in song. Hosanna, Hosanna. We sing your praises all night and all day, for you are worthy of our praise. You have given us so much. As we celebrate your triumphal entrance back into Jerusalem today, let our hearts lift you in praise. For you, God, gave the sacrifice of your Son to save us all. Let our songs of praise and worship glorify your name. Let us draw nearer to you, O Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. From our choir. Forward.
Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world.
Okay, let's see. I need a place to sit here. So I'm going to sit right here, but I'm going to grab one of these palms. Okay. Now, you know why we're doing this? Why did we come in and do this today? Well, there is a story that's going to be read here shortly about Jesus when he came into the city of Jerusalem for the very first time, right? Yeah, you know that. And when he came into town, he had arranged with his disciples at first to have a donkey that had never been ridden, and they brought the donkey in, and they put Jesus on the donkey, and some of them put their coats and cloaks and things along the way, and they waved palm branches, and they shouted, "Hosanna, blessed is the name of the Lord." Do you know what Hosanna means? It means, "Save us now, Jesus, save us now." But it's a thing of praise, and the people were letting everyone know that Jesus was their king. Now, on the other side of Jerusalem, there was a majestic horse ridden by the Roman emperor, and he came in to fanfare to let the people there know that he was in charge. And if they messed up, he would crush them militarily. Jesus is on the other side, and he is claiming to be the king. The people are claiming that he is be the king, but you know what the difference is? He was the king of peace. He said, "We will take this city by peace." The peace of God. The peace of God. Okay? So that day, at least for a little while, peace won, and the people waved their palm branches, and they shouted, "Hosanna in the highest." It was a celebration. It was a great celebration. Just like next week is going to be an even bigger celebration, because we will celebrate the fact that although Jesus died later in that week at the hands of some of those same people, and that's a crazy thing to think about, but even though Jesus died at the hands of people, he rose from the dead 3 days after he died. That's what we come back and celebrate, right? Okay, so that means celebration is part of the Christian life. We celebrate and we have joy and we have happiness and we have fun because of Jesus, who has brought us peace, Jesus who brought us salvation, Jesus who is our friend, is our God, is our brother, is all of those things, and he lives in our heart, and that's what we learned. So, what I want to say to you guys was, you know what? We had a celebration last night too, didn't we? Okay, now that was a celebration. That was some fun and joyful celebration. Not all for, you know, Jesus, but it was in Jesus' name, in the sense that we were, and it's not like we were doing bad things either, but it was like fun. It was fun, and we raised a bunch of money. And did you know that? And I want to thank you on behalf of the church, all of you that were, you did your part last night. Are you tired still? That's long. Yeah, pretty cool. Long night. So anyway, these guys up here, if you weren't there, they were like our, we would call them in, if we were at annual conference, we'd call them our tellers. They would take the ballots or they would take the table's answers over to a table of expert judges. Yes, our judges. And did you know we raised, just in the pie auction that I was being silly about and having fun, $913. That's right. People like pies and cakes, especially when they're made by people in this church. All right. So, we joyously celebrate that we could raise money for ministries of our church that are there to help people and help them along and help them get a hand up in their lives where they can also find joy in Jesus, we hope, if those that may not know that. All right, so once again we say Hosanna. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Thank you. And are we going to going downstairs today? Yes, okay. All right. So I'm going to pray before you do that. Lord, thank you for these young ones who are already learning how to serve you and already learning what it means to walk in with you in joy and celebration and fun. And so we ask that you bless them as they go to their time of learning and strengthen them in their life. In Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen. All right.
Go you can take a pastor. Yeah, take one. Yeah. Down take one. Yeah, take one. Yeah, take one. Yeah. Here, take an extra.
Here, someone needs one.
Cheryl, I think she has a joy.
No, I don't.
Oh. Okay.
Huh?
Your microphone's not on.
My microphone's not on. Okay. You want me to read them now? We'll read them now. Okay. All right. This is Palm and also known as Passion Sunday, and it's because we celebrate both of those things together. And we read from the scriptures, from the Gospel of Luke, his account, first of Palm Sunday. And we hear these words. As Jesus came to Bethpage and Bethany on the Mount of Olives, he gave two disciples a task. And he said, go into the village over there, and when you enter it, you will find tied up there a colt that no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If someone asks why you're untying it, just say, it's the master needs it. Those who had been sent found it exactly as he said. As they were untying the colt, its owners said to them, why are you untying the colt? And they replied, the master needs it. They brought it to Jesus, and they threw their clothes on the colt and lifted Jesus onto it. And as Jesus rode along, they spread their clothes on the road. And as Jesus approached the road leading down from the Mount of Olives, the whole throng of his disciples began rejoicing. And they praised God with a loud voice because all of the mighty things that they had seen. And they said, blessings on the King who comes in the name of the Lord. peace in heaven and on earth and glory in the highest heavens. Some of the Pharisees from the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, scold your disciples. Tell them to stop." Well, he did that because he knew. The Pharisees did that because they knew that the other celebration was going on with the Roman emperor. And at that point, the Roman emperor might come in and crush them if he saw them praising somebody else. And so he answered, "I tell you, if they are silent, the stones would shout." And as Jesus came into the city and observed it, he wept over it, and he said, "If only you knew on this day all of the things that led to peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes. The time will come when your enemies will build fortifications around you, encircle you, and attack you from all sides. They will crush you completely and the people within you, and they won't leave one stone on top of another, because you didn't recognize the time of your gracious visit from God." All right, so trying to remember where we began the reading. Okay, got it. Thank you. That's almost where I was going to start. That is where I was going to start. All right, and so we go up to 23:56. "When the time came, Jesus took his place at the table, and the apostles joined him. And he said to them, 'I earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. I tell you, I won't eat it until it is fulfilled in God's kingdom.' After taking a cup and giving thanks, he said, 'Take this and share it among yourselves. I tell you that from now on, I won't drink from the fruit of the vine until God's kingdom has come.' After taking the bread and giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, 'This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup after the meal and said, 'The cup of the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. But look, my betrayer is with me. His hand is on the table. The human one goes just as it had been determined. But how terrible it is for the person who betrays him.' And so they began to argue among themselves about which one of them could possibly do something like this. And so an argument broke out among the disciples over which one of them should be regarded as the greatest. But Jesus said to them, 'The king of the Gentiles rule over the subjects, and those in authority over are called their friends by the people. But that's not the way it will be with you. Instead, the greatest among you will become like a person of lower status, and the leader like a servant. So which one is greater, the one who is seated at the table or the one who serves at the table? Isn't it the one who is seated at the table? But I among you are the one who serves. You are the ones that I have continued with me in my trials, and I confer royal power on you as my Father granted royal power to me. Thus you will eat and drink at my table in the kingdom and will sit on thrones overseeing the 12 tribes of Israel. Simon, Simon, look, Satan has asserted the right to sift all of you like wheat. However, I have prayed for you that your faith won't fail. When you have returned, strengthen your brothers and sisters.' And Peter responded, 'Lord, I'm ready to go with you, both to prison and to death.' And Jesus replied, 'I tell you, Peter, the rooster won't crow before you have denied me three times that you know me.' Jesus said to them, 'When I sent you out without wallet, bag, or sandals, you didn't lack anything, did you?' And they said, 'Nothing.' And so then he said to them, 'But now, whoever has a wallet must take it, and likewise a bag, and those who don't own a sword must sell their clothes. I tell you that this scripture must be fulfilled in relation to me. And he was counted among criminals. Indeed, that's what's written about me, and it's nearing completion.' And they said to him, 'Lord, look, here are two swords.' And he said, 'Enough of that.' Jesus left and made his way to the Mount of Olives, as was his custom, and the disciples. When they arrived, he said to them, 'Pray that you won't give in to temptation.' And he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, and he knelt down and he prayed, and he said, 'Father, if it's your will, take this cup and suffering away from me. However, not my will, but your will must be done.' And then a heavenly angel appeared to him and strengthened him. He was in anguish and prayed ever more earnestly. His sweat, his sweat became like drops of blood falling on the ground. And when he got up from praying, he went to his disciples and he found them asleep, and they were overcome by grief. And he said to them, "Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray so that you won't give in to temptation." While Jesus was speaking, a crowd appeared. The one called Judas, one of the 12, was leading them, and he approached Jesus to kiss him. And Jesus said to him, "Judas, would you betray me, the human one, with a kiss?" When those around him recognized what was about to happen, they said, "Lord, should we fight with our swords?" One of them struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his right ear, and Jesus said, "Stop, no more of this." And he touched the slave's ear and healed him. And then he said to the chief priests, the officers of the temple guard, and the elders who had come, "Have you come with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a thief? Day after day I was with you in the temple and you didn't arrest me. But this is your time when darkness rules." After they arrested John, they led him away and brought him to the high priest's house. Peter followed from a distance, and when they lit a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat among them. And then a servant woman saw him sitting in the firelight, and he stared at him, and he said, "This man was with him too." And Peter denied it, saying, "Woman, I don't know him." A little while later, someone else said, "You were one of them." Peter said, "Man, I am not." An hour or so later, someone else insisted, "Then this man must Galilean." Peter responded, "Man, I don't know what you are talking about." At that very moment, while still speaking, a rooster crowed. The Lord turned and looked straight at Peter, and Peter remembered the Lord's words, "Before a rooster crows today, you will deny me 3 times. And Peter went out and cried uncontrollably. The men who were holding Jesus to custody taunted him, and they beat him, and they blindfolded him, and they asked him repeatedly, "Prophesy, who hit me? Who hit you?" Insulting him, and with many other horrible things against him. As the morning came, the elders of the people, both chief priests and legal experts, came together, and Jesus was brought before their council. And they said, "If you are the Christ, tell us." And he answered, "If I tell you, you won't believe. And if I ask you a question, you won't answer. But from now on, the human one will be seated at the right hand of the side of power, right side of power of God." And they all said, "Are you God's son then?" He replied, "You say that I am." Then they said, "Why do we further need this testimony? We heard it from his own lips." The whole assembly got up and led Jesus to Pilate and began to accuse him, and they said, "We have found this man misleading our people, opposing the payment of taxes to Caesar, and claiming that he is Christ the King." Jesus did none of these things, of course, but they trumped up the charges. Pilate asked him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" And Jesus replied, "That's what you say." Then Pilate said to the chief priests and the crowds, "I find no legal basis for action against this man." But they objected strenuously, saying, "He agitates the people with his reading, his teaching throughout Judea, starting from Galilee all the way here." Hearing this, Pilate asked the man if this man was a Galilean. And when he learned that Jesus was from Herod's district, Pilate sent him to Herod, who was also in Jerusalem at the time. Herod was very glad to see Jesus, for he had heard about Jesus, and he wanted to see him for quite some time. He was hoping to see Jesus perform some sign. Herod questioned Jesus at length, but Jesus didn't respond to them. The chief priests and the legal experts were there, fiercely accusing Jesus. Herod and his soldiers treated Jesus with contempt. Herod mocked him by dressing Jesus in elegant clothes and sent him back to Pilate. Pilate and Herod became friends with each other that day. Before this, they had been enemies. Then Pilate called together the chief priests and rulers of the people, and he said to them, "You brought this man before as one who was misleading the people. I've questioned him in your presence and found nothing in this man's conduct that provides a legal basis for the charges that you've brought against him. Neither did Herod, because Herod returned him to us. He's done nothing that deserves death. Therefore, I'll have him whipped and then let him go." But one voice shouted, "Away with this man! Release Barabbas to us." Barabbas had been thrown into the prison because of a riot that had occurred in the city and for murder. Pilate addressed them again, saying he wanted to release Jesus. And they kept shouting, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" For the third time, Pilate said to him, "What's wrong? What has he done? I have found no legal basis for the death penalty in this case. Therefore, I'll have him whipped and let him go." But they were adamant, shouting their demand that Jesus be crucified. Their voices won out, and Pilate issued his decision to grant their request, and he released the murderer, Barabbas, who had been thrown into prison because of a riot and murder. But they handed over Jesus to the crowd's will. As Jesus was led away, he grabbed Simon, a man from Cyrene, who was coming in from the courtyard, and they put the cross on his back and made him carry it behind Jesus. A huge crowd of people followed Jesus, including women who were mourning and wailing for him. Jesus turned to the women and said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, don't cry for me. Rather, cry for yourselves and for your children. The time will come when they will say, 'Happy are those who are unable to become pregnant, and the wombs that never gave birth, and the breasts that never nursed a child.' For they will say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us,' if they do these things when the tree is green, and what will happen when it's dry?" They also led two criminals to be executed with Jesus. When they arrived at Golgotha, a place called the Skull, they crucified him along with the criminals, one on his right, one on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing." And they drew lots as a way of dividing up his clothing, just as Jesus said they would, right, earlier. The people were standing around watching, but the leaders sneered at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself, if he really is the Christ sent from God, the chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him. They came to him, offering them sour wine, and they said, "If he really is the king of the Jews, save yourself." Above his head was a notice of the formal charges against him. It read, "This is the king of the Jews." One of the criminals hanging next to Jesus insulted him, "Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us." Responding, the other criminal spoke harshly to him, "Don't you fear God, seeing what you've been sentenced to die? We are rightly condemned, for we received the appropriate sentence for what we did. But this man's done nothing wrong." And then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus replied, "I assure you that today you will be with me in paradise." It is now about noon. It was now about noon, and darkness covered the whole earth until 3 o'clock, when the sun stopped shining. Then the curtain in the sanctuary tore down in the middle. Crying out in a loud voice, Jesus said, "Father, into your hands I commend my life. After he said this, he breathed for the last time. And when the centurion saw what happened, he praised God, saying, "It's really true. This man was righteous." All the crowds who had come together to see this event returned to their homes, beating their chests after seeing what had happened. And everyone knew him. All those that knew him, including the women who had followed from Galilee, stood at a distance observing these things. Now there was a man named Joseph, who was a member of the council. He was a good and righteous man. He hadn't agreed with the plan and the actions of the council. He was from the Jewish city of Arimathea and eagerly anticipated God's kingdom. This man went to Pilate and asked for Jesus' body. Taking it down, he wrapped it in a linen cloth, laid it in a tomb carved out of rock, which no one had ever been buried. It was preparation day for the Sabbath, and the Sabbath was quickly approaching. The women who had come with Jesus from Galilee followed Joseph. They saw the tomb and how Jesus' body had been laying in it. And then they went away and prepared fragrant spices and perfumed oils. They rested on the Sabbath day in keeping with their commandment. This is the account of the exaltation of Jesus as King of the Jews, and then as execution as King of the Jews, both in a very different light. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
We come to the time where now we can share our joys and concerns. I'm proud to announce that the trivia night last night altogether raised over $2,100, pure profit after all expenses.
Amen.
So thank you to everyone who attended and made desserts and snacks and had a great time. Thank you. Birthdays this week, Cameron Weeks celebrates birthday on the 15th, Shannon Moreland on the 16th. On the 15th, Carl and Paula Brookshire celebrate their anniversary, and on the 16th, Terry and Becky Hubbard. Are there other joys or concerns we would like to lift to the Lord? Becky? For Becky's brother Ed, he's having a medical procedure Tuesday. Nancy? The family of Rose Bushman.
Oh, you're with me.
You're up.
Are you having joy? I did that. I'm sorry. I was doing something else. I'm listening. I'm ready to pray now.
I turn on my microphone. All right. Let's take a moment of silence. As we listen, before we speak. Lord Jesus, O Holy One, Lamb of God that was slain, risen Christ that is now among us through the Holy Spirit, we come to you in joy of salvation that we have received from your great gift. But we also realize the suffering that you went through, and that when we are in our own times of suffering, there is a certain mercy in that, when we realize that we suffer and you suffered and there is a connection. So we bring together our suffering prayers. Anyone who's suffering mentally, physically, spiritually, financially, relationally, bring hope that there is more to life than our suffering. There is hope in our suffering. There is sunshine in darkness. And it all comes from our Lord Jesus. And so we bring all of these joys and concerns to you, O God, as we celebrate our life in you. And we receive the grace that we know we don't deserve, but we gladly receive it as you've asked us to. Fill us with your Spirit again this day. And help us to continue to follow you as your people, as your church. And we ask all of this in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. All right, our chosen scripture theme for this morning, our chosen scriptures are from for the message, from Psalm 139, and we read the first 10 verses now. Lord, you have examined me, you know me, you know when I sit down and when I stand up. Even from far away, you comprehend my plans. You study my traveling and my resting. You are thoroughly familiar with all my ways. There isn't a word on my tongue, Lord, that you don't already know completely. You surround me front and back. You put your hand on me. That kind of knowledge is too much for me. It's so high above me that I cannot fathom it. Where could I go to get away from your Spirit? Where can I go to escape your presence? If I went up to the heavens, you would be there. If I went down to the grave, you would be there too. If I could fly on the wings of dawn, stopping only to rest on the side of the ocean, even your hand would guide me. Even your strong hand would hold me tight. Examine me, Lord God. Look at my heart. Put me to the test. Know my anxious thoughts. Look to see if there are any idolatrous ways in me, and lead me on the eternal path. And from the book of 1 John, not the Gospel of John, but 1 John, there's three of these 1 John books. And if you haven't read 1 John in a while, that's a good one to pull out because it speaks so much to the love of Christ. And you'll hear that in this reading. All right. 1 John 2, 1 through 5. My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you don't sin. But if you do sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is God's way of dealing with our sins, not only ours, but the sins of the whole world. This is how we know him, if we keep his commandments. The one who claims I know him while not keeping the commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in this person. But the love of God is truly perfected in whomever keeps his word. This is how we know we are in him. This is the word of the Lord for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God for his word to us today. I'm just going to go ahead and number these so I don't lose track, just to make sure as I'm going along here, because we're going to talk about first. We're going to revisit the readings that you just heard, the Palm and Passion narratives. We're going to visit that briefly, and then we're going to jump into this idea of the spiritual discipline of self-examination and confession. We've been doing this throughout the season of Lent, and here we are at the last Sunday of Lent, and we've been talking about some Lenten disciplines, certainly not all of them, but we've been talking about many of them. But we've already said today in the Palm and Passion Sunday, we already said that that's what this is today, and we heard those back-to-back readings already. And so these accounts of Jesus coming in on a donkey and his triumphal entry into Jerusalem, and the people shouting, Hosanna, save us now. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And just days later, from some of the same people that said those same things, shouts of crucify him. Crucify God the Son, Jesus. Luke Luke's account of the events leading up to the crucifixion. And there's a lot of details there that we just heard. But through that, we can discern that by hearing these events back to back, that we as a human race can be pretty fickle, can't we? One day it's Hosanna, the next day it's crucify him. They're just being human. They're just being people disoriented by sin. One day they accept him as the one who will save people from sin and death, and the next day they're part of the religious establishment, threatened by Jesus. Make no mistake that the Pharisees and the religious establishment were threatened by Jesus, except, of course, Joseph of Arimathea. He actually found faith in Jesus, and he so much so that he gave Jesus his tomb to be buried in. The religious establishment, they were threatened by Jesus, and they thought that they were going to lose their power and their position, and then they called for the most brutal execution available. Make no mistake that Jesus died as a toxic mix of politics and religion right there that day. Now, next week, we'll come back and we'll celebrate what happened 3 days later. But today, on this final week of Lent, we look at the discipline of self-examination and confession and awareness. And in Psalm 139, David prays, "You have searched for me, Lord. You know me. You know where I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. Search me, O God, and know my heart, and test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there's any offense in offensive ways in me, and lead me to the way everlasting." Confession and examination is really a collective discipline together of examining our sinful and broken moments and habits before God, and also seeking God's grace to grow and change. Just before the reading in 2 John, I want to share with you 1 John chapter 1, verses 8 and 9. "If we claim we don't have any sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and cleanse us from everything we've done wrong." Isn't that amazing? That's an amazing God right there. So, before we go a lot further into this, there are two basic truths. If we wish to engage in self-examination as a healthy spiritual discipline, and if we don't know these truths because we have never experienced them, self-examination will either be a superficial exercise or an invitation to despair, says Marjorie Thompson in Soul Feast, the book that we've been using. But here's that first truth. God loves us. God loves us. That is a truth. There's no exceptions to this truth. There's not a person in this room who is an exception to this truth, but I bet you there are some, like myself, who one time or another thinks we are. We think, "Oh no, God, your love can't be that big because I'm unsavable." No, you're not. But there's no exceptions. It applies to you, it applies to me, it applies to all of humanity. It's not a conditional truth that applies only when you are good or pure or lovable. God's passionate and personal love for each and every human being expresses who God is. Unfailing love is God's nature, and it's the divine choice in relationship to us. God loves us with an overwhelming love that none of our sins can possibly erase. While we can grieve and we can disappoint God, nothing, not one thing we do or fail to do can alter the depth of God's love, which is a gift. It is a gift. It's a given. We cannot control whether God's love for us by our efforts to gain this love or even to lose it. Our control has nothing to do with it, since we never deserve or earn this kind of love. The best we can do is to humbly receive it, gratefully receive it as a gift, and respond to it with our very lives. And that really is the best choice. Because God desires us to make this choice. But he never forces us. He gives us the freedom to make that choice. So that first truth is God loves us. The second truth is our human weakness and brokenness in relation to God. We are creatures damaged. So this is like good news, bad news, good news. Here's the bad news. We are creatures damaged by the disorientation of sin. Sin then means... the word for sin means missing the mark, being off target, kind of like an archery term. It's like the arrow being misdirected toward the target and it misses it. That's what the Greek word for sin means in the New Testament. And so it means being off target. Instead of being aimed toward God, we are aimed toward a distorted image of ourselves. We are directed by self-centered desires, aren't we? I mean, we're chained to our needs, to unmet needs. We're compelled by illusions of who we are and what makes us acceptable or important. We strive to be in control of our very lives each and every day. In this process, we manipulate those who seem to get in the way, as well as those who appear to be stepping stones to our goals. As long as our state of misdirection makes us blind, we can't see. We can't see our condition. We really can't. Even if we believe in God, we effectively stand in God's place. And as long as we are turned in upon ourselves, we deny our essential dependence on God. We do not see how compulsively we try to manufacture our own security and our own meaning in life. An important turning point in our spiritual life comes when we acknowledge both these truths and we admit that we can neither earn God's love nor achieve our own security and perfection. We can't fix ourselves or anyone else the way we want to. Turning to face God instead of ourselves is good news. It's good news. It's the beginning of personal and relational transformation. Scripture calls this turning around what? Repentance. That's what it calls it. Facing towards God's tenaciously faithful love. It frees us to start being real. Just being real in who we are and not who we are with masks on. In the light of God's grace and mercy, we find the courage to look honestly at who we are and courageously at who we are. Bathed in God's love, we can see clearly and non-defensively all the destructive patterns of the false self that we somehow create, the facades that we have hidden behind, the excuses we've relied on to avoid taking responsibility, our habits of deception and control, our failure to love God or others or even ourselves adequately. The book of James in the Bible instructed the early Christian community to confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you will be healed. Confession unlocks a process of spiritual healing and opening up to forgiveness and cleansing and reconciliation and renewal with God. But we can't confess our sins unless we know what they are. And we don't need to dwell on those, but this is where self-examination comes in. This is where we come before God and we pray as David did, "Search me, O God, and test me and know my anxious thoughts and see if there's any offensive way in me and lead me to the way everlasting. Now, if you need to do this, and you've never done this, or you haven't done this in a long time and you have a need to do it, I have found it very helpful. I did this once a long time. You just do this once. And I find it very, very helpful. I did at the time, and I still do, to take an honest, unfiltered review of your life. And the idea here is to look at yourself, observe yourself from the outside, objectively noting character traits, habits, attitudes, and tendencies over the years. Now, two things do not need to happen. One, you don't need to put on your rose-colored glasses, and we don't need to over-positive these things. We don't need to sugarcoat them. But we also don't need to be pessimistic about them. We don't need to justify, explain, blame, judge, or excuse. And we actually write this down on a piece of paper, these things. You're simply observing yourself as with as much detachment as you're capable of by God's grace. And you know what? No one can be perfectly impartial, even to ourselves. So it's an honest assessment. This process has actually been present for many centuries of Christian practice. Somebody shared it with me along the line years ago. It's no coincidence or accident that it corresponds with the fourth step of the 12-step recovery programs. These programs still take seriously the need for specific confession to God and one another. A good friend of mine sends me a devotion from the Blue Book or whatever they call that. I'm not sure. He sends me a devotion every day. He has for the last couple of years, and he's been in recovery for many, many years. And he wants me to send these for me to see them. And you know what? I enjoy it. It keeps me aware of the importance of this process and can help keep me grounded when I get off track. But we write these things on a piece of paper. We confess them to God, and then we bring these things to God. We trust Him in His loving grace, and then we burn the piece of paper. No one ever needs to see it. Gone. It's gone. Okay? God doesn't remember your sins anyway. He remembers them no more, and neither should we. That's where we let go. It's a one-time process. It can be cleansing. It can be good to find. Because at the end of it, we find the grace of God who still loves us in spite of all of those things. Daily confession, then, is a part of our regular time that it can keep us in the process of healing and forgiving, freeing us to live in God-centered lives. And so we add the daily process to what we've already talked about with prayer Bible scripture reading, and we've talked about also with fasting and all the things that we talked about worship. These are all spiritual disciplines. And yes, I heard more than one person say last week, "I ain't doing that fasting thing." I wasn't here to tell you had to. It was, but see, that's, you know, it's a choice, and it's not really for everybody, to be honest with you. But anyway, this I think we all need to do because we all have this need. This daily confession, it frees us to live God-centered lives. Self-examination and confession allows us to become the people who are at peace with God and with ourselves, and also make peace with others. The whole point of self-examination is to become more God-centered by observing the moments when we are and when we're not. When we become more Christ-centered in our lives, God's priorities become our priorities. And if living for Christ is not at the top of our list, God gives us grace to make changes and to shift our priorities, to put God in the center of our life. In Jesus, we live a life of truth and grace. It's a balance to live this out, especially in a distorted and out of balance world that we live in. But today we leave all of this, just like that burned piece of paper, we leave those ashes at the foot of the cross where Christ has died. And next week we come back and we see the empty tomb. We celebrate that God is alive and he's living inside and that we are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen.
Open our eyes, Lord, we want to see Jesus, to reach out and touch him, and say that we love him. Open our ears, Lord, and help us to
if our ushers would come forward at this time, we will give our tithes and offerings.
We lift these gifts on high, not above you. These gifts are below you, but these gifts are raised high to offer to you back from the fruits of our labors, and we give these gifts to you as you've asked us to do, and to expand your kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. Bless these gifts and the givers in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And we now... We are studying this, by the way, one lie at a time in youth, and we just started the Apostles' Creed, and so we're going to share that right now. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried, and the third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and of the life everlasting. Amen. And of course, yes.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
I think I kind of spoiled the moment when I gave the mission moment earlier, but I'll repeat the joys. And again, we raised over $2,100 for our blessing ministry. So that's a great mission and a great moment. Thank you very much.
Amen. Praise to God. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you. It was a fun time for all. Our ascending hymn is Nothing But the Blood, number 362.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of
can wash away our sin? Jesus. He is God's way of dealing with our sins, not only ours, but the sins of the whole world. And this is how we know him. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, go in peace until we come back to say, he is risen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen.